song. North to Alaska, they go north to bless your zone.
Big Sam left Seattle in the year of 92 with George Pratt, his partner, and brother Billy, too. They crossed the Yukon River and found the Bonanza Gold below that old white...
You're getting good at this, Dad.
Well, he's a good teacher.
Oh, yeah. Padre Diablo, still here, still. We're down below, we're by the inlet. We're right near Anchorage International Airport. And that, of course, was a 747 jumbo. And one of the fun things we like to do down here is come down here and watch the planes take off. Because, hey, why not? It's kind of cool. It's kind of like going down to Sky Harbor and watch them take off there, except for here, we're on a bluff. And it's also a very big earthquake country. Kind of crazy. Anyway. KSR. I'd like to thank everybody that's been watching the show and supporting the show. This is my last year doing it, and then I got some new comrades coming in and taking over our liberal communistic video type video show where we try to warp your minds and play stuff your parents don't want you to listen to, or certain some other people. Anyway, here's another brand new video coming at you, KASR video. I'm Bob Diablo. I got Padre Diablo doing the camera, and just watching this 747 make a long arc out towards Mount Susitna here. That is something. I'd love to fly a plane like that. Mastodon, whatever you want to call it, ancient tusk, similar to the elephants of today, except for they had a lot more hair. And as reading in the paper, they said that a mammoth may have existed all the way until about 4,000 years ago on an island out in the Aleutian chain of Alaska. So that's pretty exciting news in the realm of archaeology. Come on down here, check some other stuff out. This is the Indian village. This is a Tlingit village, and they are located here in southeastern Alaska, along with the Haida and the Tishimian, and all the way down into the Seattle area, so you see a lot of their architecture. We'll cut into that. Come on down here. Stick with me, people. We're gonna do this real quick. This is the Athapascan people, and they're related to the Apache and the Navajo tribes linguistically in Arizona, and give you an idea here. You really can't see it very well, but like Navajo and Apache are right here, and also the Kiowa Apache, the Lipan, some tribes in Pacific Northwest, and then the majority of Athapascan speakers are up here in Canada and Alaska. So they figure, taking the ASU Indian history course, it's very interesting how they move down and all the legends and stuff. Okay, moving on down, another linguistic group that most of you guys are familiar with has got to be the Eskimo people, and they live, some live here in Anchorage, but most of them live around the Valdez area and up through Nome, Barrow, where all the big oil fields are. And then they turn into the Inuit people through Greenland and most of Canada. So it's pretty crazy, but yeah, this is most people you're associated with, the Eskimos, and the type of tools that they used to use to hunt and kill animals. And we're talking, they lived on the Arctic for at least 30,000 years. So humans can really adapt. I'm looking at, here's a little scene of Eskimos landing a beluga whale, which is kind of cool. And then, oh yeah, the last tribe, indigenous tribe to Alaska, is the Aleuts, like the Aleutian Islands. And they lived along this chain of islands right here, which is located on the grand picture of things out here in the far, far, far west of Alaska. In fact, if you cross the international dateline, Alaska is the most northern, eastern, and western nation, because this island right here is on the other side of the dateline. pretty crazy stuff, and then they lived on the islands. And some of the Aleuts were rumored to be a lost tribe 7 feet tall, and that was just the women. So it's pretty crazy. And during World War II, when the Japanese invaded Kiska and Attu, Attu is the far one. And then Kiska is somewhere down here. But when they invaded, the U.S. Navy evacuated all the Aleuts from here down into southeastern Alaska. And they just paid a big royalty settlement after all that because they were forced to abandon their homes, kind of like the Japanese. Hey, Bob Diablo back with you. We're still here in the Alaska Museum in Anchorage. And this is my buddy here. This is Otter and some of the other birds. I don't know what these are called. But way up here on top, we have puffins, which a lot of people mistake for penguins. There are no penguins in Alaska. There really isn't. And but they kind of look like penguins. They have the big red, you know, orange beaks and stuff. So we're still here. In fact, real quick, here we have, I believe, these are Aleutian kayaks, and also Eskimo. I think the Eskimos use something similar to this. And these are Aleutian kayaks, and they're, today's kayaks are based off of these kayaks, and these were waterproof. I mean, these people sailed the North Pacific in these kayaks between the islands, and it's amazing what they used to do that, because if you've ever seen the North Pacific is not some place where you want to like fall out and try to swim to shore, because you will freeze to death, where the water temperature is something like 20, right around 50 degrees. It's pretty bad stuff. Anyway, call 965-4163 right now, and you can get a free CD from KASR as we not only entertain, but we also inform. Here on our Grand Alaska trip, I'm Bobby Diablo, back with you with some more here. We're going to go visit some shaman houses. Padre Diablo back with you. Check it out. I'm still here with Padre Diablo. We're still in the Alaskan Museum. And this is a Tlingit house. Yeah, circa right around 1800s. And I love the Tlingits and the height of these. They have the best artwork. Come on in here, Padre. Oh, bless you. But they use very basic primary colors. We learned about this in grade school. And in a sense, kind of like the totem poles, the ornaments and the blankets all tell stories with the raven and the whale and the eagle and the bear. And they're all in there. It's really, and each one's unique. I mean, they're like same basic building blocks, but each one is different. And over here, we have just representation when the Russians were in charge of stuff when they came here. They were mainly in Sitka and everywhere else, and they hunted beaver and enslaved the native populations. And, well, it's pretty crazy stuff. And then we also have more Tlingit hide artwork. It's like a ceremonial blanket. Anyway, KASR video, we're going to cut to some more stuff. Follow up. Contrary to most beliefs, Eskimos do not live in igloos. And this is a actual representation of an Eskimo Inupiat house. And it's made out of wood and whalebone and stuff, and form the basic superstructure of the housing. And then they would enter, they'd have a deer skin or a whale skin or whatever kind of skin they could find. They'd cover the entrance of the door, and it'd be covered by moss and tundra and stuff like that. And then you come inside. So they used the igloos just for temporary housing when they're hunting. And you come on in here, it's a big wooden lodge. And well, it's kind of roomy, kind of like today's, similar to today's kind of cabins. In fact, homesteaders in the Midwest use something similar to this in Iowa. They're called sod houses. With very, very little wood, and they have wood in here, but usually it's whalebone. And they were very efficient in what part of the animal that they used. Okay, KASR video, we'll be back. We're going to show you some more whaling stuff.